Aloha and welcome to Ehana Kako, a weekly program on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. I'm Keli'i Akina, president of the Grassroot Institute. Today we're talking about shifting the Jones Act tide, and what we're really dealing with is perceptions. The Jones Act, which has been around for about 100 years, has become a permanent fixture here in Hawaii in our non-contiguous regions like Guam, Puerto Rico, and Alaska. And it impacts the entire nation and actually has an impact across the world. We'll talk about exactly what this Jones Act is. It's a set of laws and regulations that deal with shipping between American ports. But we're going to talk also about how attitudes are changing toward it. And I have today with me somebody who is superbly expert in understanding the Jones Act, and he works hard at communicating that knowledge to the public. He's Mike Hansen. He's the president of the Hawaii Shippers Council, and he's a frequent guest of mine as we work together on the project of helping to shift the tide of the Jones Act. Mike, welcome back to the program.
How good afternoon, Keli'i. Happy to be here.
By the way, congratulations on the write-up in the Star Advertiser, the column that is devoted to movers and shakers. You were featured this past week.
Yeah, that's Names in the News series. They called me out of the blue. I was very surprised and honored for that interview.
Well, what it represents is that the cause for which you stand, which is bringing some change to this Jones Act, is actually making headway. It's actually coming into the mainstream.
That's exactly why the paper said that they were doing the interview, is that for the first time they could actually see the Jones Act reform effort moving ahead.
And that's very important, because we're taking something that used to be considered rather remote, something that really didn't capture the imagination or the discourse of a lot of people, coming center stage as we see bipartisan coalitions and people who would have otherwise been strange bedfellows coming together and promoting change to the Jones Act.
That's exactly right. And that most of that's happened very recently, within the past 6 months or so.
That's right. And that's been kind of the fun that you and I have had, sort of trying to usher this thing in. And you're doing a magnificent job at the Hawaii Shippers Council. Let's just go right back to the ABCs.
Okay.
Because we've got a great audience across the world watching us here on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. And I want to say aloha to all of you. But if somebody's watching who really hasn't been introduced to the Jones Act, let's define this law that comes from 1920 in the United States. What would you say are the four basic elements that really define the Jones Act? And what it's dealing with is the cargo shipping between U.S. ports.
Right. The Jones Act is actually Section 27 of the Merchant Marine Act of 1920. And it requires that a vessel, whether a ship or a barge or whatever, to carry cargo over water must be U.S. built, U.S. flag, U.S. crewed, and U.S. owned.
Let's go through those four again, because they're just essential. Every policymaker, every legislator should have them on the tip of his or her tongue. That's not the case, but number one.
U.S. built.
All right, the ship must be built in the United States.
Right.
And that means by shipyards that are committed to building civilian ships.
Exactly. This is in reference to civilian or
That's
merchant
right.
ships as opposed to naval vessels.
Number one. Number two.
It has to be U.S. flag, which means that it has to be registered as a vessel of the United States.
Okay. Now, the third requirement.
The third requirement is that it must be U.S. crewed. Meaning that the crew that serves aboard the vessel must be U.S. citizens. And there's a slight differentiation there. All the officers must be citizens, and 75% of the crew must be citizen, the unlicensed crew. But 25% can be resident aliens, i.e. those who are holding green cards.
All right. And then, of course, the fourth requirement for a Jones
Act is U.S. owned.
U.S. owned.
Right. It has to be 75% citizen owned.
But what if the company the citizens owned is actually in the country, the United States, which is in debt to China? Would China own the
there's actually a fairly... There's been something on the order of 14 amendments to the Jones Act.
Is that right?
Since 19, or to the Merchant Marine Act, or actually to the cabotage provisions of the Merchant Marine Act of 1920. And there are on the books now very explicit language detailing how a corporation must be held.
There we go.
Or a trust must be held.
Okay.
In order to own a vessel. So it can get very complicated.
So we're dealing with the Jones Act compliant ships that meet these four criteria. Now let's cut right to the chase and say what the problem is.
Well, the problem is that these requirements, which are generally known as cabotage requirements, right, are very restrictive, more restrictive than the other coastal countries which have similar kinds of laws. And this creates an artificial scarcity, especially in regards to large ocean-going ships.
In other words, we simply don't have the supply of American-built ships that meet these qualifications of the Jones Act to meet the need and the demand for
right.
them. And so there is an artificial scarcity.
And exactly. And compounding that is that the U.S. shipbuilding industry mm-hmm. is no longer competitive in the world market.
So that's a secondary problem. In a sense, the Jones Act protected the U.S. shipbuilding industry from competition for many, many years. But during that time, the industry itself has declined tremendously. Now, let's get some numbers in this, Mike. In terms of the portion of the world's ships today that can be used for cargo carrying, what percentage do we produce?
The world fleets of ships, self-propelled ships, over 1,000 gross tons is the threshold for these kinds of fleet measurements, is 38,000 ships in the world.
Okay, there are 38,000 in the world.
Right, that's what the world fleet stands
okay.
at.
Okay, of them, how many are produced in
the
United States?
The Jones Act fleet today, the ships, self-propelled ships over 1,000 gross tons, stands at 90 vessels.
90 vessels out of 38,000 vessels across the world. We, the great United States, manufacturing empire that we once were, have 90 of them that we've produced. Now, annually, how many ships are we producing?
Yeah, we produce very few ships annually in the United States. And we're not talking tugs and barges now.
Right.
We're talking ocean-going, self-propelled ships. And since 1992, we've produced on average about 2 ships per year.
About 2 ships per year. Now, is it right that Japan produces somewhere on average of 70 ships per year?
Oh, no, far more.
Far more?
Yeah, Japan in 2013, if I remember the stats correctly, it's 346 ships, I think.
346 and that would have been in the class of Jones Act.
Yes, or in this class of 1,000 gross tons or greater.
Right.
And those were ships for export, not for internal use inside Japan, but just for sale to foreign owners.
How about South Korea?
South Korea actually produces a few more. I don't remember the number offhand.
And there are some European countries, like does Norway produce ships?
Most of the European ship construction, they were very vibrant in the 60s and 70s and through the 80s. But most of that has shifted now. The ship construction has shifted to Asia, and in particular,
okay.
Japan, South Korea, and China. Between those three countries, they produce over 90% of the world's new ships.
Okay, so to recap, the Jones Act provided a form of economic protectionism for
yes.
the American civilian shipbuilding industry.
Right.
And just like protectionism did over decades in Detroit, it's pretty much destroyed an industry by protecting it to death.
Right.
If we use a chart here, at the end of World War II, one of the world's leading producers of civilian ships. And there's been nearly a straight line, not exactly a straight line, but there's
actually
been a
decline. Actually, what happened is almost immediately after World War II, mm-hmm. the U.S. production peaked during World War II.
Okay.
Prior to World War II, most of the ship construction was in Europe. We had a very high peak during World War II as part of the war effort. That was Henry J. Kaiser. And
right.
Henry J. Kaiser and the other people who were building ships for the American government, began using production line techniques and other modern manufacturing to produce ships at a very high rate.
Now you can go ahead, even though we're on air, and have some water.
And as soon as the
And so we were producing at a high rate, and we peaked in World War II.
Right, after World War II.
Right after World War II,
the yards that had been built to construct ships on these massive scales, most of them were closed. And the construction went back to the old yards.
Okay.
And the construction techniques that had been pioneered by the U.S. shipbuilders in World War II was taken up by the Europeans. And the Europeans had quite a good run of, you know, from the early 50s through about the 80s. But those shipyards in Europe, they got saddled with all of the old constraints, and the shipbuilding essentially shifted to Japan, South Korea, and then after China opened up to China.
So for the United States, in any case, we went from being one of the world's greatest ship producers down to now today, where we produce barely 0.5% of the tonnage of these large ships that are being operated for shipping, for civilian shipping. Some of the consequences of that shortage are felt pretty severely by Hawaii and the non-contiguous regions.
One of the problems with the U.S. shipbuilding industry is that the cost of shipbuilding in the United States is now 5 times what it is in South Korea and Japan.
So let me just punctuate that here. If a company wishes to purchase a ship under the Jones Act, it must pay at least 5 times as much to buy an American ship than it would pay if it could buy from one of our allies.
Sure. You can take the same container ship, the same tanker, and we need to recognize also that all of the merchant ships that are being built in the United States are being built under license to a foreign shipyard. In the U.S. shipyards that are building these larger ships are in fact purchasing the design mostly from South Korean shipping companies. And this is true both for the tankers, for the container ships that are now being built in the U.S. And for example, Pasha, with their roll-on, roll-off vehicle transport ships, those were designed in Croatia.
How about that?
Yeah.
Well, so we have this shortage of ships that's driving up the cost of ships, which in
turn affects... first of all, the construction cost enormously
absolutely
creates this high cost. And then because the construction costs are so high, very few people build ships. So as a consequence, the ships that are in the fleet are scarce, a scarce commodity. And so the price of them in terms of chartering or paying for freight rates, because they're scarce, they command a higher price. Well, and so all this forces up the cost of shipping.
That's right. And let's talk for a moment about that cost of shipping, particularly for a place like Hawaii, surrounded by water, where we have to ship in the vast majority of goods that are here in the islands. What does that do to the prices of goods here in the islands?
Of course, it increases the price of goods. The freight rates are significantly higher. For example, it's not a perfect comparison, but in the Trans-Pacific, if you're shipping from Asia to North America, you're paying something in the order of around $1,000 per 40-foot container. If you're shipping to Hawaii and to Guam, you're paying something on the order of $4,000 to $5,000 per 40-foot container.
That's an incredible differential there.
Yeah, but you have to understand that the Trans-Pacific operates on huge economies of scale. And the ships that they're using now are like, they can carry 10,000 containers. The ships that we have calling here in Hawaii are limited by the size, and Guam as well, are limited by the size of the harbors and the total cargo volume. So even the new ships that Matson has ordered for sometime 2 or 3 years from now, those ships will still only be 3,400 TEU as compared to 10,000 20-foot equivalent units in the Trans-Pacific. So we're operating different scales.
Absolutely.
But it gives an indication of how different the freight rates are.
Another way in which prices are impacted in a place like Hawaii is because of the reduction of free trade that takes place through disincentives caused by the Jones Act.
Sure.
For example, we we don't have an incentive then for competition in the market and to have many shipping companies actually operating here. As a result, we have a virtual monopoly or duopoly in the state of Hawaii with just two companies really handling the vast majority of shipping.
Yeah, Matson has about 70% of the container market, and a company called Horizon Lines has the other 30%. And there's because the cost of constructing a ship in the United States to comply with the Jones Act is so high that most ship owners or operators who might think about entering the Hawaii trade would choose not to because of these enormously high costs to enter the market. And so this is what the economists call a barrier to entry.
Yes.
The very high cost of building a ship says to the to potential competitors, please do not enter the market. And or if you do, it's at your own risk.
In the end, the consumer is hurt the most, and of course, as well, business is hurt. Now, there's another disincentive that is created that affects our economy, and that's the disincentive for foreign trade, because it's not in the interest of many ships flying foreign flags to come to Hawaii, because if once they drop off cargo here, they're restricted from their further commerce.
Well, what actually happens is that, say, for example, if a ship were to come from Asia and stop at Hawaii and discharge cargo, this happens around 24 times a year with what are known as vehicle carriers or car carriers. And they, they'll discharge cargo vehicles at Honolulu, sometimes Kahului, and then proceed to the U.S. West Coast. There they can continue their voyage and discharge additional vehicles from Asia, cargo, foreign cargo that was loaded at a foreign port, providing, but the restriction is that they can't carry cargo from one U.S. port to another. And now that's the flag restriction.
Sure.
And that's very unlikely to be changed because there just there's too much resistance to the idea of allowing a foreign carrier to carry cargo from one U.S. port to another.
But it does have an impact on our ability to export here and the cost of exporting goods from Hawaii.
Yeah, it's difficult to say because even the freight rates from Asia to Hawaii, because the volumes are so small and the ships that are carrying that are employed on those routes are relatively small ships. Those freight rates are also very high.
Well, when we come back after a short break, let's talk a little bit more about some of the problems of the Jones Act, but then move on to talking about some of the defenses. Well, how do people defend the Jones Act, and how well do those arguments stand up? And then we'll get to the main subject today, which is talking about a shifting tide in terms of perceptions about what to do about the Jones Act. And we're in the midst of seeing that take place. I'm talking to Michael Hansen, president of the Hawaii Shippers Council. I'm Keli'i Akina with the Grassroot Institute. We'll be right back on ThinkTech Hawaii's broadcast network right after this short message.
I'm Jake Fidel. That's Sharon Moriwaki of the Hawaii Energy Policy Forum. And every Wednesday, we have Hawaii, the state of clean energy. We've been doing it for some time now, and we have some fantastic guests on there, unbelievable guests, who give us insight into what is going on in a very complex, sometimes very confusing, sometimes very disappointing area of progress in the state. So we love doing this. We love meeting them. We love talking to them. We love having their ideas out on the table. So maybe, just maybe, we can all make some sense of what's going on. Sharon, what do you think?
I think that's absolutely correct. We enjoy ourselves meeting with all these people and hearing about the energy and the state of clean energy, and hopefully we advance clean energy for the state. So it's terrific. Join us.
Every Wednesday. Okay, Wednesday is Energy Day.
Energy Wednesday.
4 to 5 p.m. Hawaii, the state of clean energy, here on ThinkTech Hawaii.
Energy Wednesday.
See you there.
Aloha and welcome back to E Hana Kakou, a weekly program on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. We're talking about shifting perceptions. We call them shifting tides with respect to the Jones Act. And today my guest is Michael Hansen, president of the Hawaii Shippers Council. I'm Keli'i Akina with the Grassroot Institute. Michael, in all fairness, what are the defenses of keeping, offered by those who want to keep the Jones Act exactly as it is. I think probably at the top is the historical argument of the national security and the importance of the Jones Act to national security. But you've thought long and hard about this and you've researched it. You have a different take than some of the traditional defenders of the Jones Act would have.
Well, yes, national defense is the primary argument for the Jones Act on a nationwide basis, because there's been attempts to change the Jones Act elsewhere in the country, just beyond the non-contiguous jurisdictions. And the primary defenses are of the national defense defenses. It's there's three legs to the argument. The first one is called sea lift.
Right.
That's the capacity that we have to move cargo, men and materiel, to overseas contingencies. And actually, the Jones Act fleet plays very little role in that. And the major group of ships that's used for sea lift are known as the U.S. Flag International Trade Fleet. And interestingly, all those ships are foreign built, and about half are foreign owned. Because they're restricted to the foreign trade of the United States, they don't have to follow the same rules as a Jones Act ship does.
And of course, on the side, there's a strong economic incentive for them to be purchased from, or to be foreign ships, because they will cost far less.
Foreign-built ships, yeah. They're foreign-built U.S. flagships.
Right.
Right.
Now, let me let you continue. What's the second leg of
the second leg of this is known as the shipbuilding industrial base. That's the argument that we must maintain a shipbuilding capacity in the United States to build ships in the event of a national emergency. And most of the people, when they talk about this, hark back to World War II, Henry J. Kaiser, and the production of thousands of ships. And that's an unrealistic assumption to make in this day and age. Because the capacity, and they say that we need to maintain a merchant shipbuilding capacity through the Jones Act requirement for a U.S. built vessel to ensure the continuation of these shipyards to be available in the event of a national emergency. The problem is there that the U.S. shipyards build so few merchant ships each year that they're not maintaining much capacity at all. And if you think about it in terms of how a conflict might arise if the U.S. had to all of a sudden start building ships like we did in World War II, in this day and age, it's unlikely that we'll have the 3 or 4 years to build up our shipping capacity during a major world war, because it would be conducted primarily, I would think, by missiles.
Yes.
And it would be over very quickly.
There you go.
And the third leg is that we want to maintain a U.S. merchant marine to maintain a cadre of seamen.
Yes.
Experienced, trained seamen for national emergencies.
Now, that presupposes that warfare is done in a certain way, and you're talking about the mobilization of the merchant marine,
sure,
for military purposes.
Yes,
what's the response to that argument?
For a major event,
yes,
like a world war, and you know, I don't know what kind of scenario planning you might want to do, but it's very hard for me to envision a scenario along the lines of World War II or even World War I, where you have a period of several years to build up a shipping capacity in order to prosecute your war effort.
So really, the national security argument really doesn't hold weight any longer because of the way the world has changed, the way warfare has changed, and so forth.
Sure.
And a couple of things somewhat betray it as well. For example, isn't it the case that when the military needs to use vessels that are not specifically military in the sense of aircraft carriers or cruisers, that they are amongst the first to go shopping for foreign vessels?
Well, yes. The U.S. Sea Lift Command actually owns and operates a number of foreign-built ships. And they do that because those ships were a lot cheaper to build or to purchase than a U.S.-built ship.
So,
but the military is using this group of ships known as the U.S. Flag International Trade Fleet, which is all foreign-built. U.S. Flag, foreign-built. They're restricted to the foreign trade of the United States, but these ships get what's known as the Maritime Subsidy Program. That's $3.5 million a year operating subsidy. And they're given preference cargoes, cargoes that are set aside for U.S. flag ships. So this is a highly subsidized fleet that's operating under the U.S. flag, all foreign built. And that's how the military is satisfying most of their requirements for sea lift. In addition to that, they will from time to time hire foreign flag ships, generally from allied owners, ship owners from allied countries. And so this is not a big problem. We've been able to solve the sea lift problem for a long time.
Now, in some ways, the logic of the sea lift employing foreign-built vessels leads us to a very palatable solution to the Jones Act dilemma today, and that is simply modifying, as your proposal does, one plank of the Jones Act, which is the first plank requiring ships used in port-to-port transport of cargo in the United States to be built in the U.S. If we could just modify that, as indeed the military has no problem with buying their ships from foreign countries, we make the whole idea of updating the Jones Act a lot more palatable.
Sure. Yeah, our proposal is to exempt what are known as the non-contiguous trades. That's the trades involving Alaska, Guam, Hawaii, and Puerto Rico from the U.S. built requirement for ships over 1,000 gross tons.
So just a couple of things that, if this is the first time you've heard that, you may want to make note of. And that's first and foremost, this is not talking about repealing the Jones Act, a nearly 100-year-old federal statute and regulations. It's about getting an exemption.
A narrow exemption, yeah.
From number two, the second thing, from a portion of it. In other words, from the requirement that the ships be built in the United States. So
right.
Exempt certain trades.
And the exemption would only apply to the non-contiguous
trades.
Right. And the reason that we believe the non-contiguous trades should have this exemption is because we in the non-contiguous jurisdictions do not have alternative to surface transportation by ocean. On the contiguous 48 states, they've got trucks, railroads, pipelines, inland river barges, mm-hmm. all kinds of alternatives.
Well, you know, this is an elegant solution, I think, because it does huge good for the consumer, but as particularly in Hawaii, but with the least political resistance.
Exactly.
And this is very different from saying we're going out to repeal this act.
For those who speak about repealing the Jones Act, mm-hmm. you're talking about a nationwide change in the shipping laws. And it would be an enormous undertaking, mm-hmm. and it would be almost virtually impossible to accomplish.
You know, it reminds me a little bit about an idea put forth by a political philosopher named John Rawls. It was called the ideal position. If we could somehow go back in time before there was an Earth and say, starting from scratch, what would be the most ideal thing? We might not come up with the Jones Act.
Sure.
But in reality, we don't have that luxury. We have to deal with the existing political world. We have to deal with history. We have to deal with perceptions, public attitudes, and politics. And so what you're talking about is taking a first step, really. You're talking about doing something that is achievable rather than holding off for the perfect.
Exactly. Don't make the perfect the enemy of the good.
Now, you've actually received some resistance from conservatives or from those who would want to see Jones Act change, in-house resistance, so to speak.
Well, yeah, there are people who are so opposed to the Jones Act that they don't see the exemption that we're proposing as doing any real good. And they want to see variously, it depends on who you speak to and it, you know, when you might catch them, is a repeal, a nationwide repeal of the Jones Act that they are advocating for, or a full exemption for Hawaii from the Jones Act, meaning that you could use foreign flagships, say, between Honolulu and Kahului.
Now, one of the arguments forwarded on that side is that if you merely exempt Hawaii and the non-contiguous trades from the build requirement, you only make life economically better for the shipping companies who buy the ships. And those shipping companies like Matson and Horizon won't necessarily translate that savings into something good for the consumer or the economy. How do you respond when you
People don't realize that the ship owners, the shipping companies themselves, the Matsons and the Horizons, oppose changing the build requirement. This is really counterintuitive for many people. They would think, well, why wouldn't the shipping company want to have less expensive vessels, especially ships, very good quality ships that you can buy in South Korea or Japan for one-fifth the price.
So, while that may establish that you're not in collusion with or on the payroll of Matson.
No, not at all.
but tell me, what is the reason that they would oppose the build requirement exemption? The reason they oppose it
is because the build requirement creates an enormous barrier to entry. That means that another ship owner, someone else considering coming into the trade, will look at the cost of acquiring ships for that trade and say that this is far too expensive. Buying ships at that kind of a price from a U.S. shipyard creates so much risk that I don't want to be involved in that business.
So if the barriers to entry into the shipping business fall
considerably,
Matson and Horizon will see competitors.
Exactly.
Competitors offering prices lower than theirs.
Sure.
And as a result, they see a problem for their own future.
Right. And also, some of the new competitors are likely to be far more aggressive shipping people who have been operating worldwide. And this will prove to be a much more competitive environment for them than what they experience today.
Well, this takes us to a tangential argument against Jones Act reform, and that is one that is often offered by the unions, and that is that Jones Act reform will result in a loss of union jobs.
It depends on what form the reform takes.
Sure.
If we're just talking about eliminating the build requirement, that will not mean a loss of any maritime jobs in the non-contiguous jurisdictions.
In fact, a greater competition in the shipping industry, more players in the field, would likely result in more ships.
Right.
In which case, there'd be a demand for more union jobs.
Exactly.
So it would be in the interest.
There's a corollary to that. In the case of at least Puerto Rico and in Hawaii, we're sourcing some of the materials that we use from foreign sources. That's called import substitution. And the reason that this occurs is because there are either the shipping costs domestically using Jones Act ships are so enormous that it's cheaper to source these goods from overseas, or that there just simply aren't the Jones Act vessels available. With a build exemption, all of a sudden, more and different kinds of shipping services could come into the trades. And that would make a big difference. All of a sudden, for example, a classic case would be LNG, which is being talked about as a way to reduce our electricity costs here in Hawaii.
Well,
and it's the same thing for Puerto Rico. They would also like to purchase. They're actually using LNG, and they would like to purchase it from the U.S. where it's cheaper, but they're having to purchase it from Trinidad at the world market price, as opposed to the domestic price that would be available off the U.S. Gulf.
And this is one of the counterintuitive things about supporting the Jones Act, because as a result, something like liquid natural gas, which we can supply in abundance in the United States, can't reach places like Puerto Rico and Hawaii because there's no Jones Act compliant ship
right.
designed to carry liquid natural
and on,
gas.
And on the other side of the trade, in Alaska, they're developing a gas pipeline to parallel the oil pipeline, the Trans-Alaska pipeline system, to bring gas from the north slope of Alaska down to the tidewater. And Alaskan policymakers, who I've been in contact with, are concerned that they won't have U.S. flagged ships available to transport some of their gas to the West Coast and Hawaii. So they're looking at it from the opposite side of the trade.
Well, and that's part of creating the stereo approach
sure.
to really what's going on. Now, going back to the LNG issue, this has forced at least one company to find an alternate way to bring LNG into Hawaii, which is to containerize it.
Right.
And in a sense, I joke with people, load it up into mats and containers and send it in little units to Hawaii.
Well, yeah, they're using 40-foot containers.
Sure.
And so the units aren't all that small. But by the same token, Hawaii Gas is the one who's importing it now. And they have relatively limited requirements.
Yes. So this isn't a systemic shift for Hawaii.
Yeah, but HECO did issue an RFP a couple of months ago asking respondents to propose moving 800,000 tons per annum of LNG from the West Coast to Hawaii in containers.
This would mean
almost 1,000 containers a week, and the logistics are just a complete nightmare. Hmm.
Well, we'll be back in just a moment to conclude today's program by talking about how the tide has shifted, how perceptions are changing, and how popular support is growing for Jones Act reform. I'm Keli'i Akina with Michael Hansen. We're on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. We'll be right back.
I'm Hong Jiang, host for Asia in Review on Tuesdays.
And I'm David Day, host for Asian Review on Thursdays. Both of us broadcast our respective shows at 4 p.m.
And my topics tend to deal with questions related to environment, culture, history, and sometimes human rights.
And my shows tend to be on international business, foreign policy, geopolitics, and national security. And you can watch our shows live on the ThinkTech website at thinktechhawaii.com.
And you can also watch us on YouTube or Olalo.
So come join us on Thursdays at 4 p.m. I'm David Day.
And on Tuesdays at 4 p.m., I'm Hong Jiang.
Aloha.
Aloha.
Aloha and welcome back to Ehana Kako, which means let's work together. That's what we say at the Grassroot Institute of Hawaii. I'm Keli'i Akina, president of Grassroot Institute, and we're very proud and delighted that we work closely with the Hawaii Shippers Council and its president, Michael Hansen, in trying to create better policy for Hawaii and the world. Today we're talking about how attitudes toward the Jones Act have been shifting. But before we get back into that conversation, a big thanks to Jay Fidel and ThinkTech Hawaii. You're doing a great job of putting together content that goes around the world and communicates great ideas. And aloha to all of you who are watching, whether you're here in Hawaii or on the mainland USA or somewhere across the world. Michael, it's been encouraging, hasn't it, to see over the last year, and as you say, even in the last 6 months, great developments with regard to bringing Jones Act reform center stage. In fact, one of them, of course, that you and I were just delighted to see was a government panel reporting under the Department of Business and Economic Development to the governor that it actually recommends Jones Act reform. Isn't that something?
Yeah, they even went further than that. This is the governor's Hawaii Refinery Task Force. And they released their final report in April. And the report said that, or recommended, that Hawaii seek an exemption from the Jones Act to allow for the use of foreign flag tankers between Hawaii the West Coast and Alaska.
In fact, this was so powerful that one state senator followed up with a news conference immediately after this, asking the governor, calling on the governor to listen to his own commission.
Yes, Senator Sloan did
that's
that.
Right.
I'm not sure the governor paid any attention to it. Neil Abercrombie has been a long time an ardent supporter of the Jones Act in all of its facets. So it's very unlikely that he would seek that sort of accommodation.
Mr. Abercrombie may not listen to Mr. Sloan, but let's hope he'll someday listen to his own commission. Now, which interestingly brings us to the Democrat Party. Here in Hawaii, there was pretty much a hard and fast line that was rarely crossed, occasionally crossed, but rarely crossed between Democrats and Republicans over the Jones Act,
where
as Democrats treated it as religious doctrine to support the Jones Act, and Republicans opposed Jones Act in its entire form. But that's shifting, and you've been a big part of that.
In the past, the Democrats, almost to a person, have been very strong supporters of the Jones Act. And that would, in part, due to Senator Inouye's very strong support. And also, because labor supports the Jones Act, the Democratic Party, of course, falls in line there.
But in 2013...
Now, there was an exception.
Yes, that's
And that was Case.
Ed Case, that is correct.
And on the Republican side, it was mixed.
Yes.
Some supported Jones Act reform, others haven't.
But one of the important strategies in bringing about change that we've articulated at Grassroots is to make policy safe for all parties.
Sure.
And from an educational point of view, we work on that. You take it a step further because you actually do a bit of lobbying down there at the legislature, and you've been involved in crafting resolutions.
Right.
In fact, you've had quite a bit of success in your resolution that you've actually advised on and crafted for calling upon the federal government for an exemption for Hawaii from the build requirement. 2013, how many Democrats and how many Republicans rallied around that?
Two Republicans and three Democrats.
Two Republicans, three Democrats. 2014, just a few months ago, what did that grow
to? One Republican and six Democrats, including Speaker Joe Suki of the House. This is on the House side now.
Six Democrats, including the Speaker of the House. Well, you know, I commend you
for
that work. But that's not the end of the story. Although the Republicans didn't rally around at that point, there has now been a shift in the Republican position.
Right. The Republican convention recently adopted a resolution supporting the exemption from the build requirement for the non-contiguous jurisdictions.
Pat
Saiki issued a statement, who is the chairwoman of the Republican Party of Hawaii, supporting our exemption. So did former Lieutenant Governor
Iona.
Also Sam Cavasso, who's running
Cam
Cavasso for the U.S. Senate.
That's right. And so really, well, that brings us back full circle, and the party's just getting bigger. I don't mean the partisan party, but the Jones Act Reform Party is getting
the support group, yeah.
and that's quite significant because I think we can anticipate an even bigger crowd rallying around Jones Act reform as we move into the 2015
legislature. And it's not just here in Hawaii either. In Guam, in April, the Guam legislature overwhelmingly approved a resolution asking their congresswoman, Madeline Bordalo,
there you go,
to start working with her colleagues and craft a bill. And we've had some success in Alaska and Puerto Rico, so we're getting the forces together.
And in addition to this, public perception is also shifting in a very positive direction. Last year, there was a poll, an informal poll, nearly 1,000 online subscribers of the Star Advertiser participated in it.
Sure.
And it showed overwhelming public support for Jones Act reform.
Exactly, yeah.
And we're seeing a lot of this. Now, I don't know if that's because the political leaders are taking the lead. Actually, it's the other way around. The political leaders are starting to listen to the people and to the think tanks and to the research that's really out there. So that's very, very encouraging as we go forward. We're delighted to be working with Michael. The Grassroot Institute is going to sponsor a journal and a symposium, a journal edition and a symposium later on in November, the weekend before Thanksgiving. And we are reaching out to representatives. Michael's helping us to find people from Puerto Rico, Guam, Alaska, and perhaps as well some of our think tank friends from other countries, to kind of create a rousing chorus, one that says the world calls upon the United States.
Well, the world has called upon the United States to change its cabotage laws. The World Economic Forum in 2013 issued a report that said that by doing away with cabotage restrictions around the world, it would increase the world GDP greater than by eliminating all the different tariffs in the world.
And the Jones Act plays a significant and inordinate role in that kind of
the world
protectionism.
Of cabotage, yeah.
I was with a shipping company owner in Singapore talking about this, and he basically said this: the Jones Act is the granddaddy of all international protectionism. So we've got an issue here that is local, that is national, that is global, and it's really a lot of fun now.
Sure.
Now, you're not getting death threats and you're not getting
your tires
slashed. I mean, that's very important because we've really hit on something where the public is on board, I think, to the extent that they know. And that's the big challenge that you and I face, both at the Hawaii Shippers Council and Grassroot Institute, and that's the task of education.
Right.
That's the task. But do you sense that there's a much broader understanding in the public, or more people understand the Jones Act than did 5 years ago?
We launched our effort in 2010 with a current reform proposal. And it's taken, you know, the better part of 3.5 years to get the word out. But it's slowly starting to change. People are understanding it better and understanding that we're not attempting or proposing to repeal the Jones Act. We're not even proposing a full exemption for Hawaii, but a very limited exemption.
That's right. And one of the things going on, too, I feel that's part of the package, is that we're bringing together people across party lines, people across even ideological lines, and people who have different visions as to how the Jones Act should be changed all together. And some of those conversations take place through our email with our friends. They're very, very lively. But the point is, whether people are promoting a repeal of the Jones Act or federal action in federal courts concerning the Jones Act or legislative remedy or the model of the Hawaii Shippers Council, we're bringing people together.
Sure.
And creating a chorus that knows what the Jones Act is, knows what the Jones Act is doing, and is calling upon government to change that. Michael, any last word, 30 seconds?
No, that'd be it, yeah.
Good job. You're doing a great job at the Hawaii Shippers Council. I'm Keli'i Akina with the Grassroot Institute. It's exciting to work toward freer markets, individual liberty, and limited accountable government. Until next week on Ehana Kako, aloha.